Hello everyone! In today's video I will give you a short introduction into the program Geneious. Geneious is really great for managing and also for working with your molecular sequence data, and we're going to use this program throughout most things in this course. If you want, you can download a 14-day trial of Geneious, which is for free, but after that you would need to buy the program. If you want to follow along with the course, maybe 14 days are enough. But if you want to do your own mitochondrial project, 14 days is not a lot of time, so you might want to buy the program. So, without further ado, we're going to start with the program. You have here an overview of the program Geneious. On the left side, you will find your folders, where you have all your data stored. You need to keep in mind that the data is stored inside of Geneious, so it doesn't matter where it sits on your hard drive, it is stored in the program. On top, you have a lot of functions which you can use to manipulate or manage your data, and in the top menu here, there are even more function hiding. In this window here, you find all your data, so if I click on this folder here, the contents of the folder are displayed in this area. If I select one of those files, I see it in the viewer down here. Also, I can select different files. The viewer, you will use this a lot to view your files and also to do some editing and so on. And you can manipulate a lot of things with the settings here. So those are the general settings, but you will find a lot of more options under here. If you want to hide this one, you can double click on this one to have it hidden if you need more space. Also, you can enlarge the view of your sequences. And you can even make them open in a new window. So you would have several windows open where you can work with several files at once, which is especially great if you work with a second monitor. Let's close this one for now. One really basic function, which is really important, is to zoom in and zoom out. So this is to enlarge the view of your sequence so you can get a view on the part you want to have. You can scroll around with your mouse wheel, or you can just use the slider down here. Let's reduce the size of this view again. And for our course, it's important to now import our next generation sequence data, but I would recommend to have a really clear folder structure. So the first thing we're going to do is to create a new folder. You can right click in here and we call this one 0 raw data. Click on OK, because in here we will store our next generation data. We will keep a numbering here so we have everything in a chronological order. Now you could go on File and Import, but it's much more easier to just drag and drop the files you want to import into Geneious. We take our raw 4x4 data and we drag and drop it into Geneious. Geneious will now import the sequences. Should it ask you if you want to have those sequences as a list or single sequences, in this case you should have them as a list, so they are stored all in one file inside of Geneious. We can now take a look at our data. Let's zoom in here and you see the blue color. This is here the sequence quality. You can also switch this to the letters itself, but quality should be fine for now. You see we have quite a lot of files in here, and also on the top here, it will display some basic information about your sequences. You can edit those sequences here if you allow editing, or you can also add some annotations if you click on Add here. So we will go over all of those little things throughout the course. I don't explain those in detail now. One important thing I want to tell you now is that you should make backups. So with File, Backup Data, you can create backups of all your files, or you can just choose to backup folders of your Geneious files. So for example, we could select this folder here and make a backup of just our mitochondrial tutorial folder. I would highly recommend to do those backups on a weekly basis, so maybe every Friday, and to have those backups also saved in a chronological order on your hard drive. I have, for example, all my backups stored in my folder for university. Of course, you only need to make backups if you change a lot of your data. If you're not working with Genius for a few months, you don't need to make backups. But it's a good thing to have also some old backups in case you delete something and you figure out a few weeks later, oh, you shouldn't have deleted those things and you need to get them back. Now I would like to introduce you to some common terms which you have for molecular data. So the first thing you should remember is that all your sequences always go from 5 prime to 3 prime end. So this here is a 5 prime end and this is a 3 prime end of your sequence. Next, we have the term mapping to reference. So in this case here, we have a reference sequence of a coral. And down here, we have mapped all our reads to this reference sequence. The black dots you see here are gaps or mismatches towards those sequences. When you do the same thing without a reference sequence, you talk about assembling your reads. Then Genius tries to figure out which reads fit together without having a reference sequence to map them against. The result of an assembly is called a contig. You see one of those contigs here. What you see above those sequences is a consensus sequence. This is based on the single sequences down here. So the most common bases you find here are summarized into the consensus sequence. At a certain threshold, like in this case down here, you see that we have some teeth inserted here and some gaps. We can't really be sure which one is correct. So in this case, we write an N in our consensus sequence. So this is an ambiguous base, which we might need to resequence to figure out which base is correct. So now you know about some basic terminology which we are using throughout the course. I will explain those things briefly again once we introduce them when we assemble our genome. All right, this concludes our short introduction into Genius. In the next step, we're going to find a reference genome which we're going to use to find the mitochondrial reads in our 4-5-4 data. So let's jump to the next video and do that.